My name is Stephanie Dombowski, and I'm going to talk about the Indian accelerated charkha today. I apologize beforehand if I lose my train of thought or if I stutter. I'm pretty much going out on a limb with just a notepad of what I want to talk about with the charkha note script. So this is my Indian book charkha. It's a relatively small size, and it's literally shaped like a book. It has this round beveled edge, and then it's got kind of like the book shape to it. And basically, charkhas have been, they were created in India or around that area. And there's the standard charkha, which is the wheel, and then it's connected to the spindle and it stands upright. Ashford makes one of the traditional charkha wheels, and you turn it by hand. It's a hand wheel and it's a spindle wheel. There's no orifice or it doesn't intake. You have to unravel and put the fiber back onto the spindle. The difference between the standard charkha and the accelerated charkha is that the accelerated charkha, the book charkha, you can pack up, take anywhere. Also, it's accelerated, which means it gets more twists per turn of the wheel than the standard charkha. And the standard charkha still has a lot of twist per wheel turn ratio. It's about one turn is 40 twists, I think, but with the accelerated, from what I've heard, it's about 80 twists per turn of the wheel, which is a ton of twist. Mahatma Gandhi actually created a competition for inventors to make the accelerated book charkha because he wanted it to be accessible. You could take it anywhere. And he really wanted to spur the movement of getting away from the English and buying their cotton textiles, you know, during colonialism when India's trying to break away from England. So Mahatma Gandhi is why we have this book charkha, which thank you, Mahatma Gandhi. So fibers to spin on the charkha, loves cotton. Short staple fibers that need a ton of twist work well on the charkha. So cotton, cashmere, angora, maybe really short wool staple. You don't want to go and try and spin a medium to long staple fiber because of the amount of twist that you get per turn. It's ridiculous. Like if you have a long fiber and you put a ton of twist in it, it's not going to be manageable. And relatively, the spindle sizes are pretty small. And if you're working with long staples, you're going to get thick, chunky yarn. And charkha is great for fine, spinning, short stapled fibers. So I'm going to try and show you how I set up the charkha. At this point, you're not going to see my face anymore because it has to focus down on the charkha. And sorry about the horrible video HD. It's on my makeshift laptop thing. So let's get started. So what I'm going to do is turn this down, and hopefully you can see it's a little dark. I didn't want it to be too light. And so there's the clip. And you're going to have the round book end of the charkha facing you. You're going to unclip it and fold it out. And, of course, this pops up. These, which I'll show you later, they are to make a makeshift skeiner. So when you're done spinning on the spindle and you need to unload your spindles, you can set this up and it will unskein your spindles, which is really awesome. And they just kind of fell out because I forgot to secure them earlier. Okay, so these go back in here relatively easily. So let me try and tilt this to show you what it looks like. So you've got the main drive wheel. This is the accelerated wheel. You've got the drive bands here. This is the handle. I'll pop it out. This is the handle. And then this little knob goes on top of the handle like this. And then this also stores, this is a caddy area for your spindles. As you can see, I started this one and there's an empty one. And then over here is where you can fit the third spindle, but it tends to not close. I pack way too much fiber onto my spindles, so I can't fit them back in. If you need a place to store extra spindles, I suggest you go to Staples, Office Max, try and grab one of those plastic pencil holders that is like a rectangular box. Those I've been told fit them well, and you can fit quite a few in there. And if they're full and you can't fit them back into your charkha, throw them in there and that'll be safekeeping. This is the distaff area where it holds the spindle, and there's a little kickstand that you can push down and it will hold the spindle, the distaffed area where you put on your spindle. It'll hold it up until you've set it up. And then there's this little thing over here, right here, which when you're unraveling your spindle, you stick it through here, and the skein part will be here, the skeiner will be here, and it'll spin. So I'm going to set the charkha up now. So pull out your pieces. This stays like this. The one nice thing about my charkha is that it's a standard charkha, but it's made with frictionless bearings. You don't need to oil it. It came ready to spin. A lot of the traditional charkhas that if you get from India, you need to fine tune it. You got to sand it down. It doesn't have these plastic parts. It has like a hemp part to connect all the wheels. So this was about $100 more. I'll tell you where I got it. It's $100 more than the traditional charkha, but it makes a huge difference if you want to spin right away and you don't want to have to get rid of all the rough parts of your charkha. So this remains here. You're going to pull the little accelerated band off. You're going to take the large band and loop it around right here. You're going to loop it onto here, flip it down, put it onto the metal part, and you're going to slide the band around until it's hooked on. And see how you barely turn this wheel, and this one turns fairly fast. So that's your accelerated band. Here is the handle, and literally there is these, there's some screws right here. You take this hole right here, and you put it on top of the big post that's sticking out, and you make sure it sticks, and then there's a little latch that locks it in. So now it works like this. Okay, and now I'm gonna set up the spindle. So this is already up. I can maneuver this around to make sure it has good tension. And so I'm gonna lock it here. It's got the little kickstand to hold it up, and I have my spindle, which I'm going to set up, and you take this band. Now, this band you're gonna put around right into this groove right here. And if you wanna spin clockwise, you turn the band away from you and hook on the spindle. And if you want to spin counterclockwise, then you turn the band, the back band right here that's closest to the camera, you turn it towards you to do counterclockwise. But I'm doing clockwise, so I'm gonna turn the front part of the band back. And then I'm going to stick my spindle in into that little nook right there. And then I'm going to pull it and let it latch in. And then take the kickstand off and make sure that this is tight enough that this doesn't move around while you spin. And see, now it's standing perfectly and you've got it spinning. Yeah, so we're good. So I have cotton. This is good sliver. Some people call it sliver, I call it sliver, whichever way you want to pronounce it. When you're spinning cotton, if this is your first time spinning cotton, you want to make sure that your cotton is easy to draft, that it's not crumpled up, because cotton fiber, once you've kind of mashed it up, it'll kind of stay matted and stuck and make it not so easy to draft. So you want to, when you're learning to spin on with cotton, you want a good sliver or a punis or whatever you're going to use that's easily draftable so that you don't have to deal with more finickiness and the troubles of spinning cotton when you first start out. Because a lot of people say cotton spinning is very hard, especially if you try to spin on a wheel. Charkhas are made for cotton, basically, because it's a spindle wheel, it gives you a ton of twist, which cotton loves, and also it doesn't have a draft intake, so you're not putting any tension on the cotton, so you're allowed to get that twist in before it tries to take it away from you, which some people have a problem trying to control their cotton, and then they don't get enough twist, and it goes into the bobbin, and then it becomes to unravel, and you can't get it started again. It's just a pain in the butt. But with charkhas, I've not had that problem, but I'm used to support spindling, which also helps you develop the one-hand drafting skill, which you need for a charkha. Okay, so I'm gonna start spinning a little bit. I'll try and take it slow so you can see exactly what I'm doing. So I'm gonna bend this back down. Okay, so just pull a little bit off and try and figure out which side spins best. There's always one side that you want to spin from because that's the way that the fibers are aligned. And if you notice while you're drafting, if you get a ton of slubs in your yarn, it may be that you're spinning from the wrong end. So try turning this fiber around and see if it drafts more easily. So I'm gonna take it. Let me get set up. So I'm going to unwind, go counterclockwise to get my spindle ready. And you want to make sure that you spin at a 45 degree angle from the tip of the spindle. If you try to spin straight, you're just going to unravel your yarn and it's not going to add twist. So have a 45 degree angle, just lay your fiber down. And I usually like to have my wheel slightly lower so that I can just turn it down here. It's something that you can put on the ground. I have a couch that reclines so I can watch TV and spin at the same time. It's kind of really nice. So you're gonna add some twist. You don't need to turn it a lot. Let me see. Let me adjust this. This needs to be adjusted a little bit more. There we go. Okay. Make sure nothing's hitting or preventing you from spinning quite easily. If you don't have frictionless bearings, you're gonna need to oil and clean your parts regularly. I add a tiny bit of oil just to make sure, because I mean, it's moving parts. I don't care if they say it's frictionless and it doesn't need oiling, it always helps. So basically, I'm gonna add a little bit of twist and then I'm gonna draft. So this is called the park and draft method. And then you add a little bit more twist, and then you can draft a bit more, and add a little bit more twist, and draft a little bit more. And then you want to turn the wheel quite a few times to add enough twist into your fiber. And then you stop, reverse to unwind the spindle, and then you wind on to your cop. So once again, I'm going to turn, going to draft, turn a little bit more, draft. Turn a little bit more, draft, turn a little bit more, draft, turn a little bit more, draft. I'm one of those people where I've gotten to the point where I can turn the wheel and simultaneously draft out, but for your benefit, I'm trying to take it slow, and then I'll go a little fast so you can see the basics. So you're gonna add some twist, stop, reverse for a little bit just to get it unwound, and then wind onto your cop. And then continue process. Draft, twist, draft, twist, draft, twist, draft, twist. And as you get used to it, it's going to become easier and you won't have so many slubs. And if you have slubs, you can stop, you can take your hand, go about, try and fix them, and then add twist. And the nice thing is it's not pulling the fiber away from you, so you don't have to worry about uptake, which is nice. And then you just wind on. And now I'm gonna do it a little faster so you can see exactly how fast I go. And sometimes I pause, you know, take your time. If you have some slubs you want to get rid of, just take your time, work it out. There's no hurry, but I'm one of those people that loves to spin fast, so I tend to just go for it. Okay, so that's basically how you spin. I know the video is running a little long. I'm going to show you the skeiner because I know a lot of videos don't show how to set up the skeiner. So once you're done spinning, you just kind of wind it on, stop. You pop out your spindle. You can put this down, pull this off. I'm going to put this there. I'm going to set this back down over here. I do luckily have a full spindle that I'm going to kind of show you how to start with the skeiner. So there's this extra part right here. I'm going to pop it out. It looks like this, and it's got two little metal things right here, and there's these two holes right at the top. You'll see it if you have a Charkha, you'll see it. It's on the top, and you just fit those metal dowels into your top of this wheel, and then you take out these metal holes again that fell out earlier, and you're going to stick them in. Also, when you're going to do the skeiner, you want to pop off this handle because this will just get in the way. Okay, so there's your skeiner set up. And then you're going to take this. The only problem I have is, depending on how you wind on your cop, it can be a little troublesome to get the fiber off, but we'll see how it goes today. So taking this, putting it over here, I'm going to feed the yarn through the hole. I'm going to wrap this around a couple times. And then I just start if it'll hold. Just hold it for a little bit until you start winding on. And literally it starts to make a skein, which is nice. And then after I'm done skeining it, then I'll wind the skein onto a ball winder. I already have a ball winder that has about 3 spindles full of fiber, which is nice. And you think these are tiny spindles, you can't get a lot done. It's amazing how fast it is to fill up these spindles because you get so much twist. Literally, I can watch tennis or watch a 30-minute video or show, and I've already finished like 1 spindle. It builds up fast. It's unbelievable. Okay, so that's how the skeiner works. Then afterwards, you can fold it all up. If you need help folding your Charkha up, there's other videos that can show you how to do that. Because my video is going long, I'm going to try and get through some other stuff really fast. So if you're interested in Charkhas, and you're part of Ravelry, if you're not part of Ravelry, I suggest you join. It's a really great resource for knitting, crocheting, spinning, weaving, anything. It's great. There is the Charkha Ravelry group. Just type in Charkha into the group search and it should show up. There's a decent amount of members. If you need help or you want more information, go there. They're great. They have tons of information. Where you can get your Charkhas, there's ones that you can get from India that are the basics that need help with sanding out, refining a bit. This one was about $100 more than the traditional stand, like Charkha, but it doesn't have any rough patches that you need to patch out. There is one woman, she's mentioned on the Ravelry group. She sells cotton sliver and other parts, and then she also sells like finished and fine-tuned traditional teak Charkhas, which are the basic model. There's also the Bosworth Charkhas. They're very nice. I think they're made out of rosewood. I can't remember what he makes, but he only makes maybe 12 or so a year. They're fairly expensive, $450 a pop. People are selling their used ones for even more on Ravelry. This one was about $200, but it basically was ready to go. I didn't have to work out the kinks, which I like. I don't have to deal with that. But it relatively compared to Bosworth price, it's a good price for a good wheel. Also, you can find used ones on the Ravelry group. People tend to have a in search of for sale area. They also sometimes post where Charkhas are being sold in the used equipment sections of Ravelry. You just look anywhere where there's spinning equipment. You might be able to find a Charkha for less than $100 or so, just depending on how much money you want to spend on your Charkha. And I believe the place that I got mine, they're actually also on eBay. They're also on Etsy. I believe it's e-trading lines or something, but if you go onto Etsy and just type in Charkha, there's one shop that kind of pops up that shows them the traditional, the standard. They also have the big book Charkha. Pretty much test out the Charkha, if you can, test out a Charkha before you buy one to see how well it works and if you really are into it. I love spinning fine fibers and I like spinning cotton too, so definitely do your research, go online. Hope this video helps. Sorry it went so long. Leave any questions or comments below. Hopefully I can get back to them. School's about to start up, so I'm kind of a recluse at that point. Thank you so much for watching this. Hope this helped out, and have a wonderful day.